kind of reminds me of the day where it is out there. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell within. For he hath founded it upon the sea and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false, nor does not swear deceitfully. He will receive the blessing of the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Lift up your head, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. Let us pray. Lord, you are the King of glory. You are the King of the world. You are almighty, and yet you care enough for us to send your Son to die for our sins, and you resurrected him and give us the hope of eternal life. As we pray, worship you this morning, let our worship be acceptable and pleasing in your sight. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Everybody, please stand. First song we're singing called 10,000 Reasons. In verse 1, it talks about each new day, and each new day is a blessing from God. And it's time to sing our song again when we rise each morning, and we keep singing until the evening comes. We're called to rejoice, we're called to pray, we're called to worship daily. So let's sing out 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name.
Please greet somebody, please.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Lord, I worship Your holy name.
All right, I'm going to stay standing. Glad to see you all this morning. It is well.
Grander earth has quaked before, moved by the sound of His voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken from my regard. And through it all, my eyes are on You. And through it all, and through it all, my eyes are on You, and it is well with me. Far be it from me, do not believe, even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. And through it all, my eyes are on You. And through it all, it is well.
It is well.
may be seated. For our communion hymn, we have nothing but the blood.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No blood of Jesus.
This particular time in our country, it's kind of, I think it's kind of an appropriate thing. There's a lot of economic rationalism these days. Unfortunately, the dollar value is placed on almost everything, and the price of everything goes up and just occasionally goes down. We're seeing a lot of that right now. But as Christians, it is good to know that we have a constant which always holds its value and is true. This is a value system that never goes up or down with the dollar or the price of gold. Jesus is our constant eternal value. In a world which is always going from one crisis to yet another crisis, it seems that the news on TV is always bad news, but the Bible tells us that there is a large amount of good news. Jesus has paid a price for us that never goes up or down and doesn't have a use-by date. Ephesians 1:6 says, quote, we have been bought through his blood, unquote. Well, and then it says, with riches of God's grace. The price was the body and blood of Jesus, God's only Son. God was prepared to pay the price, and so was Jesus. As far as God is concerned, that is the only acceptable, eternal, once for all payment for our sins. It had to be perfect. Only his perfection could bring us peace with God. That was the plan of God for us and for Jesus. Jesus knew all about it. He tried to tell his disciples many times, but they couldn't make out what he was talking about until he rose from the dead. Then it started to make sense. Throughout history, God has been preparing for this event. It was a long time coming. So the Father makes us an offer today. He says that because of Jesus, we can approach the throne of grace and receive forgiveness and peace. That's a pretty good deal. In fact, I guarantee you will not find a better one. And with that thought, let's go to our communion.
Sorry. Good morning, everybody. Let me say a quick word of prayer over our offering. Father God, I thank you so much for the collection that comes into this church. God, first of all, I pray just thankfulness to those who entrust the church with their finances, with their time, with their effort. God, I do thank you for all the things that are brought in through that offering and in turn all the things we're able to do with it. God, I pray that you give us as leaders just got a sense of responsibility to always do the proper thing and honor you with the finances that are brought in. God, I thank you for the trust that the congregation instills within us as we do use those funds appropriately. And Father, I pray that you always give us wisdom and lead us towards the things that you'd like us to use those funds upon. So Father, we thank you for that, all that will be collected today and all that always is. We love you. It's in your Son's name that I pray. Amen. Just a reminder, the offering plate is in the back on your left. That's where the offering plate is. So if the kids, we are going to go ahead and collect our pocket change. If the little one's going to go ahead and get a bucket, just a reminder, the pocket change that's being collected this month is going to Joel and Jesse in Central Asia and support the work that they're doing there. So if you have pocket change for the kids, just raise your hand and they'll make their way around. So now, as the kids are doing that and collecting, I do want to welcome everyone here this morning. I want to thank the praise team because they're always great, but that was just wonderful. Something about It Is Well is just such an impactful song for me. So I was really thankful to hear that this morning. And I do want to continue to remind you all about our Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes. We still have about 20 out in the lobby. So if you'd like a physical box, just want to remind you to take one home and fill it up. And just as a reminder, we're asking you bring those back on our Thanksgiving dinner on the 14th of November. So, Yeah, looks like it. All right, good job, everybody. And thank you again to the kids for helping us serve in that way. We really appreciate it, y'all. So at this time, I will, now that collection's done, I'll go ahead and mention that we do have children's programs. We have Children's Church with Miss Susan for those ages 4 through 4th grade. And we do have the nursery available. Sabrina and Lauren will be in there today for any families that want to take their wee
to the nursery. So, as far as prayer concerns, I have a few that I'd like to mention. Then, of course, if anybody has any, I'd love to have those so we can pray for those situations. I want to ask you all to remember Helen Perkins, who is in the hospital at St. Clair, having some issues with congestive heart failure. I want to ask that you continue, that you remember Elias this past week. He's been battling hand, foot, and mouth, and he's been pretty uncomfortable. But thankfully, he's doing better. You know, everything's about dried up and gone. So we're just thankful that he and Isaiah before him are both doing better. I want to ask you to continue to remember Barletta Sheets. She went in for a heart cath this past week, but they were unable to do the stents yet, so they're going to do a surgery this coming week. Leanne will keep me posted about that. And we want to ask that you remember Billy Phipps, who's going to have a surgery on October 28th. So just keep those situations in your prayers. And does anyone have an update or a request they'd like to mention this morning? Tommy? Frank Day? Okay. Anybody else? All right. Adam Clifford, be praying for him. Paula?
Frank Oldfield.
Okay. All right. Frank Oldfield, be praying for him.
Mitchell has his surgery Wednesday.
Yeah. The next Thursday, yeah. That's Mitchell Phipps. He's going to have surgery Wednesday as well. Yes, thank you, Jennifer. Okay, it's Andrea Phipps. That family really needs our prayers. I'm sure they'd appreciate us reaching out and supporting them. Daniel? Unspoken? Okay. Dave? Okay. Yeah, he's been on our list for a couple months now, so let's continue to remember Kevin Mays and the issues that he's having with his health. Anybody else? Sue? You say Ella Jean? Alma Jean? Okay, Alma Jean Back family. Carpenter. A White. I'm sorry, I don't know. I had a real time there. I apologize. Joe, unspoken. All right. Oh, go ahead, Grady. All right. Family of Joe Cox. Oh, sorry. Lil, go ahead. Okay. It's Lil's niece's father-in-law in the hospital. Tom Renfro. Okay, thank you. Okay. 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 We'll absolutely keep praying for her. Anybody else? Okay, as far as praises, I'll get us started. I was really thankful for the fish fry. I thought everything went well. Food was great as always. So I want to thank everyone who helped out with that and was able to be there or that just came by and supported. So I'm really thankful for that, and I want to praise the Lord for it. And like I said, I'm thankful that Elias is getting better. He was pretty uncomfortable for a few days last week. He's had an ear infection and hand, foot, and mouth, and he's cutting teeth in the back. So he's just been not a lot of fun sometimes. He's been pretty uncomfortable, but I'm thankful that he's doing so much better. So I'm going to praise the Lord for that. Anybody else have a praise or a testimony, something they'd like to share this morning?
I'd like to thank the Lord for being in God's house again this morning.
Amen.
And it's 2 weeks for me. That's kind of
uncommon. Yeah. Amen. I was glad to have you both back. Praise the Lord. Anybody else this morning? Vicki? Okay. Good. Teresa McCarty? Okay, good. I'm glad to hear that. Anybody else? All right, let's have a word of prayer. God, I thank you so much for the service that we've had up until this point. God, help us to remember that these services are offerings to you. God, yes, we come so that we may be built up and be prepared for the work you have for us. But God, our praise is what we offer to you. And God, I pray that you always find it acceptable. I thank you so much just for all the ways that we have been able to worship you this morning. God, through the reading of your scripture, through the devotional thoughts, through prayer, through communion, through offering, through the beautiful music that was made, through the time of our prayer concerns coming before you. And Father, we just ask that you continue to pour your spirit out upon this service during the sermon. God, I pray that you be with me as I go through the scripture this morning. Father, I thank you for the work that you have empowered your church to do so that we have this book, so that we have these holy words, so that we can grow closer to you. And God, I pray that I always handle them responsibly when I preach. God, it's that your words come out and not my own. God, that your spirit guides me in the way that I speak and guides all of us in the way that we hear. Father, we thank you for the freedoms that we have in this country to gather together like this. And we think of our brothers and sisters around the globe. God, a lot of them do not have this same opportunity for fear of their life, for threat of some sort of persecution. So God, we do ask you to keep them safe. But God, even more importantly, we just pray that you make them bold. You make them courageous. You give them effectiveness to their mission. And God, make us bold as well. Help us not to be so, you know, taking for granted our privileges that we, you know, fall into a sleep or we lull and stay back. God, please rouse us from our sleep in any way that we need to be more active. God, we pray for all these concerns that have been brought forward. God, we thank you for the healing that you've given in so many situations. And God, we trust in the healing you're going to give in others. Father, we pray that you give comfort to those that are mourning, that you give strength to those that are trying to recover, trying to beat some sort of illness. God, we pray just that that you be with all those that have been mentioned. And God, we know that whether we say them aloud or just think them in our mind and in our heart, God, you know what they are, and we're so thankful for that. Father, once again, I pray that you guide us through this time where we read from your scriptures. And God, we just thank you for the thoughts and the words that are going to be given to us today. We love you. It's in your son's name I pray. Amen. So we're continuing through James. We're in James chapter 4. James chapter 4. If you got your Bibles, go ahead and turn there. We will have it on the screen, but as always, I encourage you, if you got your Bible, go ahead and turn there. James chapter 4. Now, when I like to start my sermons, there's I guess no right way to give a sermon, but I like to start with an image or an illustration that clarifies a concept or a thought, especially when there's one that I want to make sure we're all on the same page with. Now, there's one today, there's a specific word that our entire passage kind of revolves around. It's not a word we hear a lot. So, I'm going to tell a brief story that I think illustrates that pretty well, and it's a story most of us have heard before, but I'm going to highlight a few things that don't get talked about as much. So, most of us are aware of the infamous Hatfield and McCoy feud. We know it's a bitter, it's not a rivalry. It's even odd to call it a feud because the contemporaries in the time likened it more to a war. I mean, they were having actual skirmishes and battles and bullets were flying, but it was this bitter hatred between these two families, and it's a huge part of Appalachian history. Unfortunately, it's not a very pretty part of Appalachian history, but it is. Now, I didn't really know the origin. I knew the story. I knew that they hated each other, and there were people that unfortunately lost their lives due to this feud, but I didn't really know the origin. What started it? You know, we know that it became this huge fire, but what was the spark that caused this feud and this hatred between them? Now, according to what I could find, there was a number of things, but there were three main things that really, really started this hatred that occurred between the Hatfields of West Virginia and the McCoys of Kentucky. It was not just the Tug Fork River that separated them. It was a deep disdain and hatred for one another. And like I said, I don't even like using the word feud, because feud reminds me of like rivalry. It reminds me of, you know, something like, do you like McDonald's or Wendy's? Do you like UK or Louisville? It seems like the stakes are pretty low. This was like a war between these families. Now, the first thing that supposedly happened was in the final year of the American Civil War, 1865. Asa McCoy was coming back from the war. He was just 13 days out of his time as a Confederate soldier, and he was killed by a group of Confederate soldiers that were engaging in guerrilla warfare. Supposedly, according to McCoy tradition, the leader of that gang of guerrilla warfighters was a man named James Vance, who was an uncle to the Hatfield family's patriarch, Ants Hatfield. Now, this one, it's not funny because of the way it all turned out, but this next story is kind of odd. A couple years later, the bad blood, of course, continued to build and build, but it came to another head when there was a dispute over the ownership of a hog. I don't know what kind of hog this was, but I guess it was a prize hog, and both sides of the family, they were fighting over it. They were so serious about this, they went to a justice of the peace, and they had a trial over who the owner of the hog was. Apparently, it had a mark on its ear that had somehow been marred, and both sides were saying, now that's a McCoy hog, because look at the mark. And the Hatfields said, no, that's clearly the mark of a Hatfield hog. And so it came down, there was a man named Bill Staton, and he ruled in favor of the Hatfields. And the McCoys were so angry, they thought this was rigged in favor of the Hatfields, that in retaliation, they killed that man. Two of the brothers got together and they killed Bill Staton. And we know that things continued over the years, and it absolutely came to a head. One event in particular, the straw that broke the camel's back. There was a daughter of the McCoy family named Rosanna. And Rosanna, in an ultimate Shakespearean Romeo and Juliet kind of tragedy move, she entered into a relationship with one of those Hatfields, with Anse's son, Johnson. Now, as you could imagine, the McCoy family was livid. She even left her family in Kentucky and went to live in West Virginia with those hated, absolute terrible Hatfields. But what made it even worse was this Johnson was not a great guy. A year later, Rosanna found herself pregnant, and Johnson dumped her and sent her back to the family in Kentucky that she had spurned. Now, in the years following that ill-fated relationship, things really started to ramp up. And in the years that followed, There was hundreds of bullets exchanged. There was fires lit of like arson. There was, you know, no telling how much property was damaged. And there was upwards of 20 people that died as a result of this feud. That's why I said it sounds odd to say a feud where you see someone in the grocery store and you bicker. This was a war. There were up to 20 people who were murdered as a result of the violence caused by these two families. And all that violence, all that bloodshed, it was due to a bitter, deeply rooted, deep-run hatred that these families had for one another. They were initially kind of opposed to each other because of the things they did, but eventually this feud came to a point where it didn't matter what they did, it was just who they are. Those Hatfields are no good. Why? Because they've got Hatfield blood. They're just bad. There's no such thing as a good McCoy. They're all low-life, pig-stealing swindlers. And when I think of this type of hatred, it's more than a feud. It's more than a rivalry. When you hear this type of hatred, it's an example of enmity. Now, that's the concept that I want us to think of. We see that through Scripture, enmity. It's not just dislike. It's not just a little bit of a feud or a rivalry. It's not disdain. It is profound hatred. It is loathing. It is abhorrence. It's an active opposition. Right, the Hatfields and McCoys weren't just wishing bad luck on each other. They were going out of their way to ensure that bad luck. They were actively opposed to one another. They were trying to damage and destroy them. They wanted to take matters into their own hands because they hated one another. Now, one of the most famous examples, and this is not our text today, but it's an example of that phrase, that word enmity being used in Scripture, is in the fall account in Genesis chapter 3. Because of the serpent and his participation in deceiving Adam and Eve into eating of the fruit of the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, that's a mouthful, God states that he puts enmity between the serpent and mankind. That doesn't mean that God made us all afraid of snakes, right? That means that there's a deep-rooted hatred between God's people and these forces that oppose them. The feud between God's creation and these adversarial forces against God will be deeply rooted, it will be intense, and it will only end when that snake is finally stamped out. Now, the Greek word for this concept of enmity is ekthra, and it's used in 6 occasions in the New Testament. This is for such an intense concept, it's used quite a bit in the New Testament. There are 6 instances, and they're all used in this similar context to what I just described. It is hatred. It's not just dislike. It's not even disdain. It is outright hatred. Now, I want you all to remember that as I read through the passage today, as you hear that word enmity, remember that description. Allow yourself to consider how serious this concept is and what James is meaning when he says it and the intense emotions that should accompany it. You know, when the Hatfields thought of the McCoys, it was an intense, passionate hatred. And so when James uses this word enmity, we should think of a passionate disdain and hate that we're going to think here. So in James chapter 4, starting in verse 1, James says, "What causes quarrels and what causes fights among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and you do not have, so you murder. You covet and you cannot obtain, so you fight and you quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and you do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. You adulterous people. Do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose it is no purpose that the Scripture says he yearns jealously over the Spirit that he has made to dwell within us, but he gives more grace? Therefore, it says God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you." Like I said last week, may you be warmed and filled elsewhere. This is a pretty difficult thing for us to hear that James is saying here. He's being very confrontational on purpose. Up to this point, his tone has not really been antagonistic or confrontational. But as we're going to look through this today, we see that he absolutely is. He tells us that the main cause of our fights, of our quarrels, of our issues is our passions. He says we have passions that are at war within us. Elsewhere, Paul says, I want to do these things, Lord, but I don't do them. And then the things I don't want to do, I continue to do. So Paul kind of explains this differently elsewhere. But James says we have passions that are at war within us. There's a battle that goes on inside of us each and every moment. And he says it all stems from this. We are unable to control ourselves. We're unable to control our desires and our passions, and so it leads to fighting. Not just fighting within ourselves, but fighting with others. If we could control ourselves and our pursuit of our desires and passions, there would be no conflict, is what James is saying here, but we know that we can't. He says we want things that we think we should have or that we think we deserve, and so we go to great lengths to get them. And so it seems probably like James is being pretty hyperbolic or exaggerative. He says, you want what you don't have, and so you murder for it. Well, most of us probably haven't ever killed somebody over something we really wanted. Maybe the McCoys did over a hog that they thought was rightfully theirs. But James here is trying to be dramatic and evocative so he can bring out the point that when we want something, we will sometimes go to great lengths to get it, no matter if it's harmful to ourselves, no matter if it's harmful to others. Sometimes we're willing to do awful things, things that we know are wrong, in order to quell our desires and answer our passions. James says that it's our covetousness, that we look at others and we want what they have, and that is what leads us to resent others and to pick fights and to be unpeaceful and unsatisfied within ourselves. And he says something really interesting in verse 3. He says, first, we do not have our desires because we don't ask for them. But then he says, when you do ask for your desires, you don't get them because you're asking wrongly. He doesn't mean that we're asking in the wrong manner. He means that we're not asking for the right things. He says, sometimes the things that we ask for reveal an issue within our hearts. Because if we're asking for things that are selfish, then that shows that there's an issue within our heart and we're asking for the wrong things. I thank God that there have been plenty of things that I've asked for, and in the moment, I really thought I wanted, and they didn't give them to me for whatever reason or another, and I thank God for that, because he certainly knows more than I or you or any of us do. But I really want us to spend some time, the whole kind of point of this passage, in verses 4 through 10, because I think they represent the main theme. And like I said, this is where James really changes up his tone. Up until this point, he's not been overly confrontational. he's extolled virtue. He has offered warnings against worldliness. He said, there's a way God wants us to live and to behave, and we need to do so. He spoke seriously, and he spoke directly. But in verse 4, look at the way he changes things up. He says, you adulterous people. He is antagonizing the reader by being confrontational. It seems kind of like he's trying to pick a fight here, but he is absolutely trying to recapture his audience's attention. And it serves his point well because he is trying to show that it is a war that we're in the middle of. It is a battle. It is a fight. Now, in verse 4, we see that Greek word ekthra pop up. Now, I'm learning Greek. I'm no expert. But that verse is ouk oidete hoti a philia tu kosmu ekthra tu theou estin. Do you not know that friendship, philia, with the world, tu kosmu, is enmity with God, ekthra tu theou? Remember, enmity is active opposition. It is hostility. It is hatred. So when James says this, it doesn't mean that we're in a little bit of a spat with God. It doesn't mean that we're in a lover's quarrel where, who knows which one's right and which one's wrong. When James says that we are in enmity with God, it means that we are actively opposed to him and his ways. It means that we're hostile towards God and that we exhibit hatred. It means that we are diametrically, totally, equally opposite and opposed to God. That's how James wants to contrast worldliness and godliness. He says you can't mix them. You can't have a little bit of one and a little bit of the other. He says they're total opposites. He says if you are a friend of the world, if you're a friend of its wicked ways, then you're God's enemy. There's enmity between you. He's very blunt. He says your alliance with the world shows the contents of your heart. Because if we're not actively following God, then we are actively opposing him. He's speaking in really polar binary terms here. It's one or it's the other. There should be no love lost, no sense of cooperation between God's people and the ways of the world. And I want to ask us this, how seriously do we take such a teaching? Because we should take it terribly, terribly seriously. But he is saying it's one or the other. So as we consider ourselves, how seriously do we take such a teaching? To what lengths do we personally, just some reflection, to what lengths do we go to avoid choosing the world over God? What do our actions show about whom we are aligned with? Do our actions show that we are a child of God, or do our actions show that we are a friend of the world? James is intentionally using language that is powerful, that is dramatic, that is evocative, because he's trying to make his point. We are in a conflict. We are being confronted by the world, and we must choose God. We are with him or we are against him. We follow him or we are hostile towards him. There's no in between. Either God is opposed to us because of our pridefulness and our vain attempts to control our life and our fate, or he gives us the grace that we need as we humble ourselves before him. And thankfully, James doesn't just give this tough instruction and leave us to ponder what we do in response. We're not hopeless. We do not have to continue to live in a state of enmity or ekthra with God. He tells us if we submit ourselves to God, if we obey him, then he will continually dole out the grace that we need, and he will provide us with mercies afresh daily. He tells us that if we resist the devil, he will flee from us. If we resist the devil, he will flee from us. We are not bound in devotion to him, nor are we bound to the ways of this world. The nearer we draw to God, the more closely he will hold us to his heart. And how do we draw near to the Lord? We can't neglect verses 8 through 10. This is so important. The Bible tells us that God is holy, thus we are called to be holy. And so if we wish to be drawn nearer to God, we must be willing to repent. That's what James is describing here, verses 8 through 10. We must cleanse our hands that have been stained by the work of our sin, the work of our iniquity. We ask the Lord to purify our hearts that have wandered far from his presence. Our former friendship with the world is not flippant. It's not to be taken lightly. We must fully, 180 degrees, turn away from our past and into the future that God has prepared for us. He says you ought to be sorrow for your past, your transgressions. When you repent, when you turn from these things, it's like a mourning, considering the ways that we've affronted God. He said, be ye wretched and mourn and weep. It's not a fun response, but it's the appropriate one. When we realize how holy God is, and when we realize how unholy our sinful past was, it's the appropriate response. And I want us to consider this. The sin in our lives. Now, I'm not saying once God's forgiven us of something, you know, that thing's in the past, right? That's dead and buried with the old person. But the things that we're continuing to do, the things maybe we're not being so truthful about, the things that we're hiding within us, I want us to consider this. Do we treat sin in our lives seriously enough? Because sin is a serious affront to God. He is a holy God, and we must acknowledge him as such. It tells us that God will only exalt those who humble themselves before him. So if we're unwilling to kneel before God and humble ourselves before him and acknowledge our sins, then he's going to be unwilling to offer us the forgiveness that we desperately need. That's part of repentance, is turning away from those things, not just saying I'm sorry a million times and not meaning it. God is holy. He is without sin. The righteousness of God is diametrically, totally polar opposite to worldliness that James is talking about here. There is enmity between God and sin. There is enmity between the righteousness of God and the works of the world. And so I offer, as James did to his audience, church, we cannot afford to be in a state of enmity with God, because woe to those who are considered as God's enemies. Because if we are hostile towards God, if we are actively opposed to him and his purposes, it is not going to end well for us. But thankfully, praise the Lord, because of his grace, we don't have to remain in such a state. When we acknowledge that Jesus is the Savior, He is the Christ, we are no longer God's enemies. We are no longer bound or condemned to hell because of our sins. We become His children. That enmity exists no longer. He is no longer opposed to us. He is no longer hostile towards us. And instead, He will pour out His grace and His mercy afresh on us daily. And so as I bring this to a close, I'm going to leave all of us with James's words. I can't say it any better than he did, and I'm all going to try. I leave us today with James's plea to his audience. And I pray that we heed these words wisely. Once again, verses 7 through 8, he says, "Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." Let's pray. Father God, I thank you so much that you love us enough to offer us the ability to turn away, to choose between you and the world. And God, it shouldn't be a choice at all. And it's so unfortunate that so many people choose against you. But God, I pray that if there's anyone in here who is stuck in the works of the world, God, they have never acknowledged your son Jesus as the Christ, the Savior. They're still living and basking in that sin. God, I pray that they understand what this choice is. God, I pray that we all understand, first of all, what enmity means, how deep and how passionate and how serious it is. And God, help us to understand that if we're not with you, then we are against you. If we are not your children, then we're your enemy. And God, there is enmity between us. God, you're opposed, or we're opposed to you, so you're opposed to us because of our pride to choose against you. God, there is hostility between us and you because we are counted among your enemies. But God, I thank you so much for the grace that is offered through your son, Jesus. Father, I am thankful that he takes these hands that have been absolutely stained with sin, that have been stained because of my iniquity, God, and he makes them clean. God, I thank you that because of Jesus and my faith in him, this heart that has been filthy and dead can be not just cleansed, but brought back to life. God, it can be purified. But Father, help us to understand that you're holy, and if we want to draw near to you, we too must pursue holiness. God, we pursue your son, we try to do the works of righteousness, and we avoid, like the plague, the works of the world, those wicked and evil works. Father, help us to resist the devil and trust that because of your power that lives within us, your spirit, he will flee from us. And Father, I just want to thank you and praise you that you give us the opportunity to repent. God, as long as there's breath in our lungs, it is not too late for us to turn back to you. God, I pray that this congregation and those within it, God, not only that we have repented, but God, that we model repentance. God, that we show the community around us what repentance looks like, what it's like to submit ourselves to you and humble ourselves before you and bow on knee before you and say, "Lord, I have been bad, I have been broken, I have been damaged, but I am no longer your enemy. God, you love me. I'm forgiven. I'm made clean and washed because of the blood of your son, Jesus, that was spilled in his sacrifice." God, help us to model repentance. And God, anytime we are offered the choice between worldliness and godliness, God, help us to choose right. And we know what that answer must be. God, we follow you above all things, above all people, above all authorities, above everything. Father, we thank you for this scripture. I pray that if there's anyone in here who has not acknowledged your son Jesus as their Savior, as their King, as the Christ, God, I pray that they do so this morning. I pray that they don't leave here as an enemy of you. God, that enmity is taken from them. And God, they leave here knowing that they are your child. Father, we love you. It's in your son's name that I pray. Amen. I want to ask you all, as always, to stand and reflect on these thoughts and just reflect on God's graciousness and all that he's given us during this final song. And if you'd like to come forward to pray, I would love to meet you at the altar.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you, and I'm lost without you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your every word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe.
Amen. I got a few announcements. So the Ministerial Association did meet yesterday, and we are going to have the countywide revival in November. It'll be the first week like it would have been October, so it'll be the 1st through the 5th. It starts at 7 o'clock. It's at Index, not the church, but the gym, the community center next to it. I don't have right off the top of my head who's going to be preaching throughout the week, but I know that information's in the paper, so you can look for it there. But I want to invite you all to come out and be a part of that. That's November 1st through the 5th at Index Gym at 7 o'clock. So want to mention the revival. Next Sunday after church, we're going to have a youth dinner just as a way to fundraise for TCTC. They're having it this year, so we're going to try and go. So that is in January, but the dinner is this coming Sunday. We're going to have soups and stuff like that, and hopefully have quite a few of our youth here to help us out with that. So we want to ask you all to stay around after church next week and help support the youth. The pantry tomorrow, as always, want to invite anyone who's available to come and help. We will have the prayer circle following the service. And then the last thing they have came out with when the trick-or-treat schedule is going to be, I think they're doing something a little different this year. There's going to be like a drive-thru up at the fairgrounds. I'm not totally sure about that yet. But that's going to be Friday the 29th from 6 to 8 p.m. And I would like us just to have, we're not going to do trunk or treat or anything huge, but I would like to see people at the church just giving out candy and something like that. So if you have candy you want to bring, that'd be great. But really, we just need a couple volunteers that would be willing to do that, to give their time to be here. I'm going to get some information about service times and stuff like that, and maybe, you know, print out some verses and stuff we can give the kids too. So if you'd like to volunteer with that, just make sure and let me know. Anyone else have an announcement? The shower, the shower for the shelter, that sign-up sheet is still out there on the bulletin. Just a reminder, we're just trying to collect some goods that will help us to be better hosts if we ever have to host people because of an emergency or, you know, a weather incident or something like that. So if you want to help with that, you can just sign up out there. If you don't mind, make sure to write down if you're going to buy something. That way we can just kind of keep track of what all is coming in. And I do want to thank the deaconesses again for their work in putting that together.
We are not going to do the fire pit tonight.
Not going to meet tonight. Okay, we'll meet next week. So we're not going to meet tonight for the fire pit, but we will meet next week. Yes, thank you, Kent. Anybody else? All right, let's close with prayer. Father, I thank you for the service. I thank you for the many opportunities we've had to worship. And God, I thank you for this congregation. I pray that you grow us closer together each and every time we meet. God, I pray that just as Paul, when he would write his letters, he would say, when I'm not with you all, I think of you. I long to see you again. I love you. I enjoy to be in your presence. And God, I pray that you increase that within our congregation. Even if we just see each other once a week or maybe a couple times a week and it's not for very long, God, just increase that fellowship, that love, that camaraderie between us. But God, more than anything, just keep us focused as we run the race that goes heavenward. God, continue to prepare us and give us wisdom for the work you have in this community. And God, I just want to reiterate once again, help us not just to be people who live out repentance in our lives, but God, we are clear examples of what it means to seek forgiveness, to turn from the world, and to turn our hearts, incline them towards you. God, help us to show those in our lives, be they friend, family, stranger, coworker, whatever. God, help us to be a seemingly small change that can make just a tremendous impact on the kingdom of heaven. Father, we love you. It's in your son's name that I pray. Amen. Thank you all. So let